For the next hour and 30 minutes, this program will present in person such bright stars as...
Louis Armstrong!
Bob Hope!
Deborah Carr!
Frankie Lane!
Jerry Lewis!
Dean Martin!
Darley McGuire!
Jimmy Wallington!
Meredith Wilson!
And my name, darlings, is Tallulah Bankhead.
National Broadcasting Company presents The Big Show.
So listen, America, the curtains of America, we're going to fill your heart and hold us.
The Big Show. 90 minutes with the most scintillating personalities in the entertainment world. Brought to you this Sunday and every Sunday at the same time as the Sunday feature of NBC's All-Star Festival. And here is your hostess, the glamorous, unpredictable Tallulah Bankhead.
Well, darlings, here we are with the big show this week in Los Angeles. Los Angeles, the city of the angels. Or is it Los Angeles? The city of the angles. Well, to be safe, I'll call it L.A. Lousy with S's. How did a whiff get in there? And what a plane trip from New York, darlings. We worried all the way. When we left New York, we were worried about the weather because all we could see was rain. When we got to Chicago, we worried because all we could see was snow. But when we got to lovely California, we stopped worrying because we couldn't see the weather at all. Smog, you know.
Of course, you know what smog is, don't you?
Well, Bob Hope.
Thank you. Smog. Smog is nature's protection against the glare of Crosby's shirts. Or, smog is the stuff they invented to protect the oranges from the smudge pots. Or...
Just a moment, darling. La Brea Tar Pits, Madman Munts, Mulholland Drive, Wilshire Bus, and Hollywood and Vine.
What's all that, darling?
I just wanted to get all your local jokes out of the way so we couldn't clutter up the rest of the big show.
Well, you left out Anaheim, Azusa, and Cucamonga.
We don't mention them on this network.
Oh, I see. You mean on account of J.B.?
That's exactly what I mean, darling.
Well, what have you got against Joan Blondell?
I am not referring to Joan Blondell. It just happens to be a name I'd rather not mention on the show. Now, Bob, what have you been doing lately?
J.B., a name you can't mention on this show. Oh, I know, isn't that stupid? I mean, of course, Jetty Bavis.
Bull.
Oh, Jack Boer, of course. Look, Chaloo. I'll tell you why I came over here, besides grabbing a little loot. I want you to do a guest shot on my radio show.
Oh, darling, do you have a radio show of your own? Who's the mistress of ceremonies on your show?
Nobody. Who's the mistress of ceremonies on your show? Don't tell me you haven't heard my show back east every Tuesday at 9 o'clock.
I never get up that early, darling.
No, honey, you're thinking of just plain Bing. I'm on Tuesday night from 9 to 9:30.
Oh, only half an hour. Oh, Bob, I'm terribly sorry, darling. What do you do with the other hour?
We wait for the laughs to come in. Look, let me set you straight in this radio racket. All comedy shows are a half hour.
I beg your pardon. My show's an hour and a half.
I beg your pardon. Only scenes that long. How about it, Tallulah? Will you come on with me next Tuesday night? We rehearse the script Monday morning.
And we rehearse with the orchestra Monday night. Then we have a complete dress rehearsal Tuesday afternoon. We go on the air with the show Tuesday night.
Oh, that fits in perfectly with my plans. I'll be there at rehearsals Monday morning and with the orchestra Monday night. And at the dress rehearsal Tuesday afternoon, I just won't be able to make the show Tuesday night, darling. Will that be all right, Bob?
Oh, that sounds reasonable. Of course, if you can't be on the show, I'll only pay you half the salary.
Oh, I don't think that's fair. After all, I am coming to 3 rehearsals, and just because I miss one show, which only takes a half an hour...
Skip it, kid, skip it. For the money I'm paying you, I can get Jenny Bavis not to come on the show.
But, darling, it's not my fault. You would have to pick a Tuesday this week. I'm free Monday and Wednesday. How did you happen to pick Tuesday right in the middle?
Oh, just lucky, I guess. Look, look, Alabama, let's level here. Are you coming on the show Tuesday or not?
But, Bob, if I'm going on your show, what do you want me to do on it?
Well, you'll do what all my guests do.
But I never had 4 sons.
Well, what can you do? Wait a minute. No, that's not supposed to tie in, you know. I promised him I wouldn't read it that way. I didn't do it, honest.
Control yourself.
Well, what can you do?
I sing.
It's just as funny the second time. Let's go, Chalou. They're giving us a finger. Go ahead. What's up? I mean the wind up. You know, the thing.
But of course, I'll have to bring my own accompanist.
What'd you say?
I said, of course, I'll have to bring my own accompanist.
I haven't got that. Where is that? Okay, who is he?
Well, he just happens to be Meredith Wilson and his 47-piece orchestra and chorus. I can't sing unless they accompany me.
Oh, you have a special orchestra that plays flat?
They do not. Now, you listen. To Meredith Wilson and his big show orchestra and chorus in a brilliant rhythmic arrangement of Orange Colored Sky.
I was walking along, minding my business, when out of an orange colored sky, wonderful, you came by. I was walking along, drinking in sunshine, when out of an orange colored view, crash, bam, alakazam, I got a look at you. One look and I yelled, timber, watch out for flying glass. Then the sea fell in and the pond fell out. I went into a spin and I started to shout. I've been hit. This is it. This is it. I was walking along, minding my business, when love came and hit me in the eye. Crash! Bam! Alakazam! Out of an orange-colored sky.
That's the accompaniment I want to use when I sing on your program. You see, Meredith keeps me on key.
Baby, your voice should be kept under lock and key.
What's the matter, Miss Bankhead? Didn't you like my number?
What's your problem, Meredith Wilson?
I only said, didn't you like my orchestra number, Miss Bankhead?
Of course, darling. Now, look here, Bob. If you're implying that my voice is bad...
Now, wait a minute. I'm no music critic. Don't start sending me any letters. Personally, I'd rather write than be president.
Well, Miss Bankhead...
Wait, this is creeping up. Wait a minute.
No. I wanted to say to Miss Bankhead, when I finished my number, you usually say that was delightful, Meredith, or charming.
That was delightful, Meredith, or charming. Bob, if you want me on your show, I'm going to sing, and the song will be, Give my regards to Broadway, remember me to Herald Square, tell all the gang on 42nd Street that I will soon be there.
Hey, Rivet Voice, you're tearing up 42nd Street again.
I could have played Give My Regards to Broadway if you'd asked me to, Miss Bankhead. I have it in all the keys you sing it in. That's A, B, C, D, E, F, and G.
When she just sang it, it sounded more like H.
Don't pay any attention to him, Meredith. Don't pay any attention to him, darling.
How can I? I haven't even met him.
Oh! I beg your pardon. Meredith, darling, this is Bob Hope. Bob, this is Meredith Wilson, darling.
Glad to know you, darling.
Gee, Mr. Hope. Mr. Hope, this is really a happy moment.
For whom?
I've always been one of your greatest admirers, Mr. Hope. I used to see all your pictures back in Mason City. I was born there, you know. That's my hometown. Mason City, Iowa.
Meredith, you are not going to tell one of those repugnant stories about that obscure little hamlet of yours, are you?
Oh, glad you asked me. Well, sir, Miss Bankhead, I used to see everyone in Mr. Hope's pictures back in Mason City, Iowa. Well, I remember going to the movie one night and I had to take standing room.
I know, boy, my pictures sell out all over.
No, it wasn't that. I had a sacroiliac. Had to stand up. Doc Frisbee, he's the druggist there.
And, you think he can help that?
I went there to the druggist, but he's closed up, so I went to the bicycle shop and they taped me up with that black tape they put on bicycle handles.
Well, they tape up seats with that stuff, too.
Yeah, that's what they did. Well, sir, I stood up all through that picture, laughing and scratching.
Look, Itchy, how much more is there to this nauseating little bear?
Well, that's about all there is, except that when they took that tape off, wow, I've still got the scars. Would you like to see them, Mr. Hope?
No, no. I'll wait till they come to my neighborhood movie.
Meredith, if you're quite finished with that black...
Hey, look at the size of that orchestra. Hi, fellas.
Hey, look, it's still there.
Hey, go right on, fellas. Don't let me stop the show. I'm just cutting across to my studio.
Hey, what a musical aggravation. Every musician I ever fired is in that orchestra.
Look at that violin section. Who's got the rosin concession there?
Mr. Harris, I don't know how you managed to stagger into this studio. But if you don't crawl off before I count to one, which I understand is as high as you can count... I will have you forcibly ejected.
Ejected? Well, push, pull, and click, click. Hey, Bob.
Huh?
Hey, Robert, what are you doing on this program?
Mostly straight lines.
Hey, Bob.
Hmm.
Hey, Robert, who's the bass tomato?
This tomato's going to be a surprise. It's Tallulah Bankhead.
That's Tallulah Bankhead?
Yeah, that's what you like about the South.
Well, corn my pone if it ain't a lotsman.
And what carpet bag did you creep out of, Mr. Harris?
Baby, don't fight me. I'm filthy.
I don't care what state your clothes are in.
That thing you're wearing could stand a retread too, girl.
Well, the war between two states. You notice how cleverly they set this thing up so that every time I'm about to sit down, I have a line to see him speak? I have one to see read, yes, I do. Luckily, my bicycle seat is taped, and I can't sit down anyway.
Hey, Meredith, I didn't see you.
Hi, Phil.
Well, old Meredith, you still playing that long hair stuff?
Yep. You still playing that curly hair stuff?
Sharp as a marble. By the way, Meredith, we were talking about you at the Musicians Union the other night, and some of the boys think that you're kind of eccentric. They heard through the Hollywood and grapevine that you read music. Now, I'm a committee of one to find out. Are you now or have you ever been a reader of music?
Well, yeah, I read music. Don't you?
Oh, once in a while when I'm sitting under the dryer. But it's the same old story, Meredith. Do, la, so, fa, mi, re, no action. That kind of stuff went out with the three B's, Bach, Beethoven, and Benny.
How dare you, Mr. Harris?
What do you got against Benny Goodman? He's the king. I might even say he's the thing.
He's the what?
Hey, don't tell me you ain't heard of the thing. Hey, local, this girl don't know about the thing. They know what it is. Well, I got to go, kids. Hey, Robert. How about you and the missus and me and Alice stepping out tonight after the show?
Oh, sure, Phil. By the way, how is Alice?
Just left her a couple of minutes ago. She was in the pink.
Well, have her slip into some clothes and we'll go out.
Oh, Robert, gee, I wish I'd have said that. I could use that on my show today.
You will.
Well...
Bob, what was that thing?
It's not that thing, it's the thing. It's a piece of music that can only be written by a guy who can't read music.
Meredith, have you heard of this thing, the thing?
Oh, sure. It's one of those tunes that don't make any sense. You have to have them every once in a while. Like, I remember back in Mason City, Iowa.
Oh, dear. Meredith, we're not going on tour through that one-night stand again.
Well, I was just talking about things like the thing. Like we used to have. You remember Yes, We Have No Bananas?
That was before my time, darling.
Your time was before bananas.
I know everybody used to sing that song. I knew it so well that I could sing it backwards.
Yeah, that should be very interesting.
Oh, it is. It goes, today bananas, no have we. Bananas, no have we. Yes.
And that's the thing.
Oh, no, the thing came later. First, we had this.
Yes! We had no bananas. We had no bananas today. We string beans and onions, carpaccios and shaddies, and all kinds of fruit. And today, we have an old. We have no bananas. We have no bananas today.
And then we had another one. This was really the thing, called Three Little Fishes. And then came the Hutsuck song.
Hutsuck. Hutsuck Rawls. Hutsuck Rawlson.
Hot sauce frog, soon on the railroad, and a frolic, frolic too. Hot sauce frog, soon on the railroad, and a frolic too.
But what about the thing?
Well, we got that, too. Here, be my guest, Miss Bankhead. Here's a copy of the music. Just read that lyric.
While I was walking down the beach, one bright and sunny day, I saw a great big wooden box floating in the bay. I pulled it in and opened it up, and much to my surprise, I discovered a... right before my eyes.
Oh, I discovered it. Right before my eyes. I turned around and got right out of running for my life. And then I took it home with me to give it to my wife. But this is what she hollered at me as I walked in the door.
Oh, get out of here with that. And don't come back no more.
Oh, get out of here with that. And don't come back no more. The moral of the story is if you're out on the beach and you should see a great big box and it's within your reach, don't ever stop to open it up. That's my advice to you, because you'll never get rid of it. No matter what you do,
oh, you'll never get rid of it. No matter.
Does that answer your question, Miss Bankhead?
Well, darling, I can't say very much for the melody, but I must admit the lyric was quite dull.
You know what I like, Meredith? That hot horn in your band. He plays a lot of trumpet.
Why, that's Louis Armstrong. Louis, darling, what are you doing in the orchestra? Come over here.
Hello, Tallulah.
Louis, how are you? Oh, I want you to meet Bob Hope.
Oh, I know this cat, man. He's gone.
You said it, Louis. I've been gone for about 8 pages now. Tell me, L.A., you playing that trumpet around L.A.?
No, B.H. I've been up in La Lillevee.
Oh, Las Vegas, huh?
Yeah, man.
Well, how'd you make up there at L.V., L.A.?
Okay. Where'd you up there, B.H.? How'd you make out?
P.U.
What happened, B.H.?
The roulette wheel. I went for a G. You see L.A.?
Oh, yeah.
Are you gentlemen making your initial appearance on radio? Louis, I was hoping you'd mention that article I wrote about you for Flair magazine. You see it?
Oh, I did, Tallulah. I thought it was very...
Louis, you went over that word 100 times. I told you it was erudite.
Yeah, oh, I think that's the word.
Thanks, Louis. Sweet of you to say that, Bob. Did you read the article I wrote on Louis Armstrong?
Yes, and I thought it was Erwick.
Yeah, that's the word.
You're just joking, I know. Oh, Louis, you are my favorite musician.
Thank you, Tallulah.
And Bob, you're my favorite comedian.
Thanks, Tallulah.
Well... hasn't one of you gallant gentlemen anything to add?
Oh, sure. May I return the compliment to Lou and say that Louis is my favorite musician.
Thanks, Bob, and you're my favorite comedian.
Boys, shall we go around once more?
Oh, sure. To Lou, I'm your favorite comedian.
And I'm your favorite musician.
This is fun. Let's play it again. This time for money.
If anybody's going to play anything, Louis is going to play it. fabulous company. How about it, Louis?
That's what I came here for.
Ladies and gentlemen, a real treat. Louis Armstrong with Meredith Wilson's orchestra in Phil Moore's brilliant arrangement of a song I know you all want to hear, Ain't Misbehavin'.
No one to talk with, all by myself. No one to walk with, I'm not the only shell. Misbehaving, save my life. Oh, the bitter, bitter, bang, bang. Now for certain, the one I love. Through dreading, you better think it of. Misbehaving, oh, babe. I does the bitter, bitter, bitter. Like Jack Horner, in the corner. Don't go nowhere, and I don't care. All your kisses went really far. Believe me, I don't stay out late. Don't care to go. All my body, me in the radio. Leaves me having strange
as ever, Satchmo. Louis, you know what my ambition is? I want somebody to make a recording with you. Someday. Right or wrong. Press on, darling.
Well,
I want someday to make a recording with you, Louis.
Well, what have you got against me, Louis?
Now, just a minute, Armstrong. I sing, you know.
Oh, yeah, I heard about you singing.
Oh, you heard about it really well? Mm-hmm.
I was standing on Broadway and a man came up and gave me your regard.
Must have been one of those Herald Squares. Look, Tulu. If you want to come on my program and sing, this might be a good time to show what you can do. Louis, how about it? Could you improvise a little something for Tousle Top?
Anything you like.
Okay, baby, let's hear something. If you're going to audition, let's do it now. I don't want you to louse up my show.
Me audition?
Me, Cleveland Indian.
Besides, darling, I'm not prepared.
Oh, you didn't bring your voice with you, huh? So much the better. Come on, I'll help you out.
Oh, no, Bob, no, no, no.
Oh, come on, let's make her sing. How about it, folks? Well, if nobody wants to listen to her, I...
Now, just a censored minute, Hope. If they want to hear me sing, I'll sing. And we'll leave it to the audience whether I sing on your show or not.
Okay, anyone else? Last chance, sedatives, sleeping pills, revolvers. Yes, ma'am, we have earplugs. No, madam, only two to a customer. What do you mean you need three?
Louis, you'll need a couple of those earplugs.
Gotta lay a couple of those earplugs on me, too, Daddy.
Well, I'm certainly not going to listen to this by myself. Give me a couple, too.
Okay, Louis, let's hear it. I'll start you off, Tulu.
This is a lot of fun, darling, but I have to ring my chimes. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Fund.
My melancholy, babe, and we're off the air. Yes, well, let's go.
Oh,
Big Show. This is the National Broadcasting Company's Sunday extravaganza with the most scintillating personalities in show business. The Big Show, the Sunday night feature of NBC's All-Star Festival, is brought to you by your local Ford dealer, who is now displaying the new 1951 Ford, the car that's built for the years ahead, by RCA Victor, world leader in radio, first in recorded music, first in television, by Chesterfield, the only cigarette that combines mildness with no unpleasant aftertaste, the cigarette that brings you Bing Crosby and Bob Hope, and by the makers of Anacin for fast relief from pain of headache, neuritis, and neuralgia. The big stars on this program are Louis Armstrong, Bob Hope, Deborah Carr, Frankie Lane, Jerry Lewis, Dean Martin, Dorothy McGuire, Meredith Wilson and his Big Show Orchestra and Chorus, and every week your hostess, the glamorous, unpredictable Tallulah Bankhead.
Yes, darlings, this is Tallulah broadcasting from Hollywood, Bankhead, telling you that if you don't listen to the Big Show, you're a big schmo. Or if you're in a stew and you don't know what to do, listen to Tallulah. And you'll never be blue. So new.
Well, Tallulah Bankhead, girl burl.
Bob Hope.
Thank you, Tallulah. I'm happy to be here with you on your second Hollywood version of the Big Show.
Oh, it's nice having you, darling. Nice to catch you on the ground for a change.
Yes. I have been traveling a lot lately, but I've got to stop it. I have so many labels on my trunks, the laundry won't take them anymore.
Darling, I know the sacrifice you're making, giving up the Los Angeles Rams-Chicago Bears championship game at the Coliseum.
And you're not kidding, but that's all right. I've got to keep working. After all, I'm a comedian. I have a government to support. But it's nice being here with you, Tallulah, during the Yuletide season. Of course, whenever I think of Christmas, I think of my old folks back home. Take it, Iowa. You know, Christmas season brings out the sentiment in a body. Yes, sir. I'm the kind of guy who does a lot of traveling, but I'm like anybody else. No matter where you go, you never get very far away from that old hometown. And I was reared in Cleveland. I can remember way back to the time I was a baby. I was born in a poor family. My mother couldn't even afford talcum powder. She used to turn my little body over and sprinkle it with Dutch cleanser. Till I was 10 months old, I didn't know whether I was a boy or a kitchen sink. That's why at Christmas time, I like to go back to Cleveland to see my folks. And they're always happy to see me. Of course, they're just as happy getting it by mail, but I always feel sentimental about my hometown. With all the friendly faces, the familiar buildings, Main Street, Elm Street lying parallel to it, and my Uncle Louie lying parallel to both. People said he was a drunkard, but he wasn't. He only drank a little bit to steady himself. Sometimes he got so steady he couldn't move. My family were very poor. We lived in a little shack, just two rooms and a path. But even though... but... couldn't hear it, huh? But even though... But even though we were poverty-stricken, I was even sophisticated as a baby. I was so high class, I wouldn't suck my thumb till they put it in a cigarette holder. But my mother was one of those dear hearts and gentle people. She tried to raise us right, even though we were broke. She couldn't buy us underwear, but she did the best she could. She lined us all up and painted buttons on our stomachs. She couldn't even afford to buy me a haircut. My hair was so long, till I was 19 years old, I thought I was a St. Bernard. I found out I wasn't just in time.
I was going steady with an Airedale. But what a picture comes to mind when I think of the old hometown. Old Pappy Walker sitting in front of the general store carving a sailboat in a bottle. I wonder if he ever got out of the bottle when the sailboat was finished. And then there was Miss Drainafor, my old teacher. I can still see her sitting in the classroom, an old lady just knitting. She was knitting an old man. On a vacation, Miss Drainafor used to go to the big city and burn the candle at both ends. For weeks after, she couldn't put on a hat or sit down. And when I think of the Yuletide season, I always think of my parents. My father was a great man and a big practical joker, too. So was my mother. They finally played a trick on each other. Me. You know, I started the first quiz show in Cleveland. When I was born, my father took one look at me and asked the doctor, "What is it?" Doctor answered, "Well, I missed that one. Can I stand by for the jackpot?" Father was betting on a boy and mother was betting on a girl. But doctor won. He had me across the board. But we were a proud family, people of the soil. We'd been farmers for generations, and everything we did was connected with the soil. In fact, we were the dirtiest family in the state. But it was a happy family. My father worshipped my mother. He got her everything. He wasn't wealthy. He was a shoplifter. When he walked out of a department store, the whole left side of the building sagged. Like all families, we were hit by the Depression. My father was hurt in the crash of 29. The runway at Minsky's collapsed on his head. Well, before I knew it, it was time for me to go to school. I was enrolled in a finishing school for backward children. And I did very well. I started in the eighth grade, and in no time at all, I was back in kindergarten. It was in the third grade that I first fell in love. I know it sounds kind of silly to be in love with the third grade, but don't forget, I was 38 years old. And I'll never forget the first time I kissed my little girlfriend. She was wearing braces, and I was wearing braces. And when we kissed, our braces locked. After that, we went everywhere together. Then came graduation time, with all the kids in their caps and gowns. I caused quite a sensation. My gown was strapless. And I did very well in sports at school. I had a typical athlete's physique. Big chest, hard stomach. But that's all behind me now. I used to play football when I was in school. It was part of the cure. And all of the fans around Cleveland knew my name. It was painted on my bucket. I had a very peculiar nickname. They called me Neckline Hope. I was always plunging down the middle, but never really showed anything. My first year, I was disqualified from playing football for a scholastic reason. Stupidity. I thought the big nine were my toes. It was right about then that I met her. Yes, her. I never did find out what her name was. She was a vision of loveliness. She had long blonde hair and luscious red lips, which she wore in a bun on the top of her head. But the best part about her was that she was tattooed. That made it nice for me because I couldn't afford a television set. So we almost broke up. I'd seen the picture before. We were very much in love. She called me baby, and I called her my little pussycat. I called her pussycat because I thought she'd take the hint and shave off her whiskers. Finally came the day of our wedding. She was a sentimental girl, so she got married in her grandmother's dress. She looked lovely, but her poor grandmother almost froze to death. It was a lovely ceremony, except for the kiss. My nose created a suction, and we had to be separated with a razor blade. Yes, we were married. And tomorrow marks our 25th anniversary. It'll be 25 years since we've talked to each other.
Ladies and gentlemen, the new 1951 Ford, the car that progressive planning designed, engineered, and made come true, is at your Ford dealers now. And everything about it tells you that here is a quality car, a fine car that's built for the years ahead. When you examine the 1951 Ford, for example, take a good long look at its luxury lounge interior. You'll find styling, fine coachwork, color-harmonized Ford craft fabrics that are years ahead in beauty. When you drive the new Ford, notice how the automatic ride control literally adjusts the ride to the road and makes the roughest bumps easy on you, easy on the car itself. And there's more, much, much more. In all, there are 43 new look-ahead features, each designed to give you added value for the long years to come. Yes, indeed. When you see the 1951 Ford, when you drive it, you'll agree it's the finest Ford ever produced.
And now, darlings, the two young Paramount stars who have taken the country by storm, the only comedy act in show business that can possibly follow Bob Hope, Dean Martin, and Jerry Lewis.
Okay, thank you very much. That's very sweet of you, Tallulah Bunkus. We're very happy. Very happy to be here. You've been on for over a half hour already. Wash up, get your money, and get out of here. Social Security number. We'll take over now. Here we are on the big show. You know this is the day.
Hey.
And I was
hey.
Here.
Hey, Jerry. Crazy? What's wrong with you? You got to conduct yourself like a gentleman on the big show. Now, don't rouse me up here like you do everywhere else. Aren't you happy to be on the big show?
Ask me no questions. I'll tell you no lies. I don't like her.
You don't like Miss Bankhead?
Young man.
Dean, she's going to hit me.
Come on, Jerry. Now, come on. Let's settle down.
All righty, Dean. We'll have a cup.
All righty, Dean.
No, because you said, let's settle down. We'll have a cottage small by a waterfall with roses rambling round the door and the patter of little feet across the floor.
Yeah, mice.
No, but Dean, I don't like it here. Come on, let's go back to the marble tournament. I'll treat. I got two Aggies.
No, Jerry, you don't understand. Miss Bankhead was complimenting us by saying we were the only act who could follow Bob Hope.
Us she compliments. Everyone else she insults. I told you she didn't like us.
Oh, but Jerry, darling.
I did not come here not to be insulted.
Well, Jerry, if you won't listen to reason, I'm going to call on your partner, Dean Martin, to sing.
Well, I'd be glad to, Miss Bankhead.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dean Martin will sing.
Dean, she's going to introduce you for all these years. For all.
My tongue got in the way of my eye tooth. I couldn't see what I was saying.
Yeah.
Dean, she's going to introduce you. For all these years, we have been partners, and now you are going to let her introduce you. What are you doing to me?
Miss Bankhead, would you mind if Mr. Lewis introduced me awfully?
As I'm sure only he can. All right, Mr. Lewis, we'll introduce the song. What are you going to sing, Dean?
LaVie and Rose.
You may introduce him, Jerry.
Thank you. Mr. Martin, I want to introduce LaVie and Rose. LaVie and Rose is my partner, Mr. Martin. But this is a very beautiful LaVie and Rose arranged and conducted. I should say conducted by Meredith Wilson. This is arranged by our own wonderful conductor, Mr. Dick Stabile. Dean Martin sings LaVie and Rose, and this is swell.
never or will be.
Is she for real? When did she make the living?
Now, Jerry, don't tell me you've never heard of Tallulah Bankhead. Jerry, I'm speaking to you. Why don't you answer me?
You told me not to tell you I never heard of Tallulah Bankhead. I made a boo-boo.
Look, Jerry, you made a double boo-boo. Tallulah Bankhead is a great stage actress. Surely you saw her in Private Lives.
I don't butt into other people's business.
No, Jerry, it was a stage show. Didn't you see it?
I don't remember. What was the picture playing with it?
There was no picture playing with it, just a stage show.
She's been in a lot of stage shows. She played in Rain.
That's how she got so hoarse?
Ah, come on now, Jerry. Haven't you heard of Tallulah Bankhead and the Little Foxes?
Oh, she's an animal trainer.
No. Tallulah Bankhead in Skin of Our Teeth.
Skin of Our Teeth?
Oh, come now, Basil. This has gone far enough. Far enough to you hear. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? I said far enough to you hear.
Gene, are you listening?
Jerry, you don't seem to get the idea. Now, I remember taking you to a play once. I even remember you stopped into the lobby and you got yourself a glass of orangeade.
Oh, yeah. I remember the orangeade, and the girl with a flashlight told us we could sit down in the seats and be comfortable while we were drinking the orangeade. And a fella came out and sang something about an enchanted evening, and a girl washed her hair, and a bunch of sales were running after some dames, and a girl was saying, happy talky talky happy talk. What you have to go through just to drink a lousy glass of orangeade.
That's the place, Jerry.
I went back there, you know. There was such a crowd waiting, I couldn't get in. I guess everybody found out they have the best orangeade in town.
Now you got it. That's it. Tallulah Bankhead in the theater.
Oh, now I know. She's the one who makes the orangeade. From this, she makes a living.
Ah, Jerry, stop being so stupid.
So how will you make a living?
You know, this is tougher than I thought it was going to be.
Please be patient with me, Dean. I've got a terrible headache.
Where do you keep it?
Ha, 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 ha. That's very funny. You see, I said I got a terrible headache, and he says, where do you keep it? He's making out like I haven't got a head.
Joke over.
You don't have to explain my joke.
So, Dean, what are friends for?
All right, come on, let's get back to the theater.
I'm not thirsty.
Well, boys, how's it going?
Dean, she's back again. Don't let her hit me.
Well, why don't you stop? She won't hurt you.
Could I feed her?
She's very friendly.
Could I scratch her behind the ear?
Dean, tell me, is he for real?
I often wonder.
I want to apologize, Miss Bankhead. I shouldn't have been so fresh. Dean told me all about your sickness. Does it hurt much?
Does what hurt much?
The skin of your teeth.
Why, you little half-sized, half-idiot, half-imbecile.
Dean, she did it. She likes us. We're in. She insulted us.
She didn't insult me.
Dean, don't worry. She said half. We're partners. You get half of everything I get.
Say, Bob Hope, what's all this I hear about giving Crosby for Christmas?
Well, Bing's Papa Santa Claus this year, you know, in a Chesterfield Christmas carton.
Bob, it's a very nice gift. I've already bought several. But tell me, why aren't you on the Christmas carton, too?
Well, I was supposed to be Jimmy, but old Sag has gotten so fleshy there just wasn't room. Seriously, folks, Chesterfield Christmas cartons are the best thing you could give or get because Chesterfield is the milder cigarette, and you can prove that yourself. Just make the Chesterfield mildness test. by Chesterfield. Open them and enjoy that milder, mellow aroma. Now light one up, and you'll know Chesterfield's milder because it smokes milder. Another thing you'll notice, Chesterfield leaves no unpleasant aftertaste. That fact has been confirmed by the country's first and only cigarette taste panel. So for all the smokers on your list, give Crosby for Christmas. Give Christmas carton to Chesterfield, the only cigarette that combines for you mildness with no unpleasant aftertaste. Tallulah.
Yes, Dean, what is it, darling?
My partner Jerry and I were thinking...
That's very funny. Let's get on with the rest of the show.
Wait a minute, missus. He didn't tell you yet. So what are you laughing for? Dean Martin has something to tell you, and he is my friend, and I would gladly die for him. Would I not, Dean Martin, die for you?
Sure he would. Go ahead, Jerry. Sure. Drop dead.
I can't die today. I don't feel so good.
Darling, stop being morbid. What were you going to say, Dean?
I speak. We would like to meet Mr. Bob Hope in person and make a deal with him. Do you think he'll sell us some jokes or maybe trade us some jokes?
Well, why don't you talk to Bob about it? Come on, Bob, darling. Here, the boys want to do some business with you. You know Mr. Martin?
Oh, sure. Hi, Tony.
And Mr. Lewis. And Mr. Lewis.
Hi, Joe.
Hi, Mort.
Time out, conference. Dean, you think he really doesn't know us, or is he making a joke?
Making a joke.
Darling.
Mr. Hope, we'd like to consummate a little deal with you. Would you sell us some jokes, or maybe you'd be interested in trading a few jokes?
Oh, I don't get you.
Well, I'll give you for instance. I'll give you a brand new joke I made up today out of a magazine. For one of your old jokes.
Well, what's the joke?
A joke. You say to somebody, I went to see Albert Einstein. And somebody says, how did you find him? And you say, I pushed back his hair and there he was. Now you give me one of your old jokes.
No deal.
Now, wait a minute, Mr. Hope. Don't pass that joke up. You know, there are two other jokes you can make out of it. Now, like, how did you find your steak? Oh, I pushed back the potatoes and there it was. Or, how did you find the West? I pushed back the onions and there it was.
If anybody asks me how I found Martin Lewis, I'll say pretty dull.
All right, Mr. Hope. I'll make the supreme sacrifice. I got a brand new Groucho Marx joke.
Really? Brand new?
You bet your life.
Okay, I'll trade you even up. Somebody fall down? What was that? Brand new, I bet your life. That's well, anyway, okay. Somebody's wearing a neon nose here. I don't know. Say, okay, I'll trade you even up for a brand new Phil Harris.
All right, that's a deal. Let's see it.
Oh, no, sight unseen.
Okay, here you are. I got it written down here.
Okay, and here's yours.
Wait a minute, fellas. You're playing without me? Who blew up the ball? So I want to trade, too. I got a brand new Fred Allen. I'll trade you for that Phil Harris.
That's a trade, kid. Here you are.
And here are you.
Now, let me see what this says.
Yeah, let's read them.
How did you find Albert Einstein? I pushed back his hair and there he was.
Here's a word from RCA Victor. Only 6 shopping days left till Christmas. But that's not bothering America's snappiest families. They need only 1 day to select the greatest family gift in history. An RCA Victor complete home entertainment combination. They're pooling their dreams and their money to buy the gift that keeps on giving. And giving and giving. Giving not just to one, but to all. Giving not just a day, but every hour, every day, every year. Giving not just RCA Victor radio, or recorded music, or television, but all 3 combined in 1 magnificent cabinet. Why don't you join together and agree this minute to meet each other next Monday at your RCA Victor dealers to choose your matchless RCA Victor radio phonograph television combination? You'll find it costs far less than you'd pay for each instrument separately. You'll find that your RCA Victor combination is the greatest gift each of you ever made to the year-round happiness of all of you.
Darling, Darlings, prepare for some excitement. Appearing with us in a few minutes will be two glamorous movie stars, members of the Actors Company, Deborah Carr and Dorothy McGuire. Deborah Carr can currently be seen with Stuart Granger and Richard Carlson in Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer's Technicolor production, King Solomon's Mine. Oh, and yes, don't think I'm forgetting another star on our show, Frankie Lane. It's just that I have a little funny way of my own to introduce them.
Hey, Joke, Tallulah, how will you find Deborah Carr? Dorothy McGuire and Frankie Lane. And I say,
I'll just push back my chimes and there they'll be. This is NBC, the National Broadcasting Company. Well, darling, I suppose you've noticed something unusual about our big show today. So far, there have been no women. A present company accepted, of course. But we are just about ready to make up for it. What with Deborah Carr and Dorothy McGuire on our show. Oh, what am I doing? There's still another man whom I haven't presented, and what a man.
You know I'm here, Tulu. I've already been on.
Not you, Bob. I'm talking about Frankie Lane.
Well, what's so special about him? Let's skip Lane and get to the girls.
Hey, Dean, look who's sitting there. Two big movie actresses.
Well, don't get excited, Jerry. So are we.
We're movie actresses.
Are you through, crew?
Say, don't crowd, fellas. There's enough here for everybody.
Thank you, darling.
And one left over for somebody.
Two girls and three boys. It don't come out even, so I'll choose first.
No, you hold it, Jerry. I'll take Deborah Carr.
Now, it's one girl and two boys. Eeny, meeny, miny, Meyer. I will choose Dorothy McGuire. Okay, Dorothy? Dean, I don't think she likes me.
Don't be silly, Jerry. Of course she does. I think you're a handsome, intelligent, attractive young man. I think you're real nice.
So if you like me, you take me out.
I'll tell you what, Germ. You and I'll take Deborah.
Oh, yummy. I'll take Dorothy McGuire. Okay, fellas, we're all set to take the girls out after the show. Pass the sense, then.
Now, just wait a minute. I've been standing here listening to this juvenile Casanovian drivel with ill-concealed contempt. Using this show to divide up two lovely ladies is a disgusting display of ill manners and bad taste as I have ever seen.
Hello, Miss Bankhead.
Ah, Frankie Lane, darling. We're just in time, Frankie. We're just in time.
Okay, fellas, we're all set to take the girls out after the show. Pass the sense, then.
Now, just wait a minute. I've been standing here listening to this juvenile Casanovian drivel with ill-concealed contempt. Using this show to divide up two lovely ladies is a disgusting display of ill manners and bad taste as I have ever seen.
Hello, Miss Bankhead.
Ah, Frankie Lane, darling. We're just in time, Frankie. We're just in time. Three of us couples are going out after the show.
Okay, I'll take Dorothy McGuire.
She's spoken for, darling.
So, okay, I'll take Deborah Carr.
Sorry, someone's taking her. Well?
Well, I could call my wife. Maybe she'll want to go.
Isn't he sweet? Well, what about me?
Well, if my wife can go, we'll need a babysitter.
What? Sing your song, Lane.
Okay, I'm going to live till I die. Meredith, if you please.
If you're troubled by the blues, wise up before you reach the end. Oh, don't be so unhappy, my friend. Be like me. I'm gonna live till I die. I'm gonna laugh instead of cry. I'm gonna take the town and turn it upside down. I'm gonna live till I die. They're gonna say, what a guy. I'm gonna play for the sky. Ain't gonna miss a thing. I'm gonna have my fling. I'm gonna live till I die. The blues will lay low. I'll make them stay low. They'll never trail over my head.
I'll be a devil till I'm an angel. But until then, hallelujah, gonna dance, gonna fly. I'll take a chance riding high. Before my number's up, I'm gonna fill my cup. I'm gonna live, 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 live till I die. You gotta laugh instead of cry. You gotta play for the sky.
You gotta sing and have your sing.
So I'm gonna laugh.
He's gonna laugh.
I'm gonna play.
He's gonna play.
I'm gonna sing.
Smile.
Dance and live. Till I die. I'm gonna laugh instead of cry. I'm gonna take the town and turn it upside down. I'm gonna live, live, live till I die. They're gonna say, what a guy. I'm gonna play for the sky. Ain't gonna miss a thing. I'm gonna have my fling. I'm gonna live, live, live till I die. The blues will ring so low, I'll make them feel the solo. They'll never trail over my head. I'll be a devil till I'm an angel. But until then, hallelujah, gonna dance, 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 gonna fly. I'll take a chance riding high. Before my number's up, I'm gonna fill my cup. I'm gonna live, live, live till I die.
Live, live, live until I die.
Before my number's up, I'm gonna fill my cup. I'm gonna live, 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 live until I die.
Here is something you should know if you ever suffer from the sudden pain of headaches, neuritis, or neuralgia. It's a way to ease the pain, often within a few minutes. A way that is incredibly fast and effective. It's Anacin. Anacin is like a doctor's prescription. That is, Anacin contains not just one, but a combination of medically proven active ingredients in easy-to-take tablet form. Thousands of people were first introduced to Anacin through their own physicians or dentists. But today, these tablets are in such widespread use that all drug counters have them, and anyone may enjoy their benefits. Next time you suffer from the pains of a headache, neuritis, or neuralgia, by all means, try Anacin. You'll like the convenience of Anacin tablets, and you'll be delighted with Anacin's incredibly fast action. A-N-A-C-I-N. Anacin. Ask for Anacin by name today at your druggist.
Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome to the big show the Actors' Company of Hollywood, which is composed of some of the outstanding creative artists in Hollywood, who have brought the living American theater to the West Coast. Tonight, the Actors' Company has graciously invited me to appear with them in a radio adaptation of Claire Booth Luce's Broadway play, The Women. The scene is in the living room of Mary Haynes on Park Avenue, the time, afternoon, the occasion, Canasta. Dorothy McGuire appears as Peggy, Deborah Carr as Mary, and I play Sylvia. Ladies and gentlemen, the Actors' Company.
Excuse me, Sylvia. I think I'd better join the others. I haven't seen Mary's children yet. They're just back from the park.
Wait, Peggy. I've got something to tell you. I'll burst if I have to wait.
Oh, I knew you had something. I'm not sure you should tell me, Sylvia.
Now, don't be stupid, Peggy. Stephen Haynes is two-timing Mary. He's playing around. He's got a girl.
Oh, I don't believe it. Is it true?
Wait till you hear. Now, you know I go to Michael's for my hair. You ought to go, pet. I despise whatever does yours. Well, that's the most wonderful new manicure there. Aren't my nails divine? Look, dear, a jungle red.
Go on, Sylvia. What are you trying to say?
Well, now, this manicure is just marvelous. I was doing my nails, and I was looking through Vogue. You know, the one with Mary in the Beaux-Arts ball costume.
Oh, yes, she wore a white powdered wig, and she looked lovely.
Yes. Well, now, this manicurist, Mrs. Fowler, she said, Is that the Mrs. Haynes who is so awfully rich?
And what difference does it make to her?
Oh, I forget what she said next. You know how these creatures are. Babble, 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 babble. Never let it for a moment. When suddenly she said, I know Mr. Haynes' girlfriend.
Oh, how could you listen to her?
Listen to her, my dear. How do you suppose I felt? I couldn't very well shut her up. I mean, I had to find out who the other woman was.
Does Mary know about this?
No, but she's bound to find out. If a woman's got any instinct, she feels when her husband is off the reservation. I know I would, but not Mary. If only there was some way to warn her.
Sylvia, you're not going to tell her.
Why, certainly not, my dear. But I'd die before I'd be the one to hurt her like that.
Couldn't someone shut that manicurist up?
A good story like that? A lot these girls care whose lives they ruin.
Dirty, isn't it?
Foul. My dear, the whole thing's disgustingly unfair to Mary. I feel her like a disloyal skunk. Well, just knowing about it. You know, I worship Mary. She's my dearest friend in the world.
Heaven, help her.
Shut up, Peggy. Here she is. Shut up.
I'm so sorry to have kept you. I was talking to Stephen. Where are the others? They're in with the children, Mary.
Well, darling, how is Stephen, the old dear? And did you give him my love?
I did, Sylvia. Stephen's not so well.
Oh. What's the trouble?
Nervous indigestion. That's why I have a plain cook now.
Oh, there's nothing worrying, Stephen.
Oh, no. He's just been working late. He's not coming home again tonight.
Oh, are you sure it's work, darling? You're not a beautiful blonde.
Oh, Sylvia.
Well, Stephen's a very attractive man.
Isn't he? I can't imagine why he hasn't deserted me for some glamorous creature long ago.
Oh, Mary, you do sound smug.
Oh, let me be, Peggy. How can you be too sure of what you believe in most?
I wouldn't be sure of anyone if we were able to get up and totter across a room. I always tell my spouse, if you ever manage to make a fool of me, I'll deserve what I get.
You certainly will.
Oh, Mary, have you seen my new nail color? How do you like that?
It's attractive, Sylvia.
Oh, you can't imagine how it stays on. I get it at Michael's. You ought to go, Mary.
Sylvia.
Oh, a wonderful new manicurist. Olga's her name. She's marvelous.
Let's play canasta.
Now, look, Mary, they call it jungle red.
Looks as if you'd been tearing at somebody's throat.
Well, that does it, Peggy. I'll never tell you another thing.
That will be just fine.
Now, girls, I really do like Sylvia's polish. It's new and smart. Michael's? Olga, jungle red. I remember that. Shall we cut the deal, Sylvia, you and I? I feel lucky today.
Do you, darling? Well, you know what they say, lucky in cards.
Michaels, Olga, jungle red. Yes, I went to Michaels, and I had my nails done by Olga. And I had my world destroyed, too. I found out what my friends already knew. Stephen had another woman, Crystal Allen. The place they send wives with shattered worlds is called Reno. It wasn't long before we were there. Oh, yes, Peggy and Sylvia had to go, too. Divorce seemed to be catching.
Well, Sylvia...
What are you doing in Reno, Peggy?
I couldn't resist the slot machine.
I can imagine. Well, relax, darling. You'll get a better break from those one-armed bandits than you got from dear husband John.
And I suppose you came here for the rodeo?
Don't be crude, dear. What if he does look a little bent when he's not on his horse? He's the best I could find in this town. At least I'm not going to sit around and mope like Mary.
Now, don't start anything, Sylvia. This is Mary's last night. She gets a decree tomorrow. I'm praying she'll get a call from New York tonight.
You mean Mary would take Stephen back?
Well, why not? Why not? You think I wouldn't take John back? That is, if we hadn't feuded so terribly over money.
Oh, stop sniveling. You and Mary have no pride. I'd roast on a spit before I'd take Howard Fowler back. Kicking me out like that after all I sacrificed.
You did? What did you do?
I gave him my youth. But I got paid plenty. The skunk.
Oh, Sylvia, why do you hate Mary so?
I don't hate her. It's just that she was always so smug about her husband and her happiness. Now she's down like all the rest of us.
Yes, Sylvia. I'm down now. We're all in the soup together. By the way, here's a letter that came for you.
Oh, thanks. I haven't heard from Stephen, I suppose.
No.
It's too late for that, I'm afraid.
Oh, well, sweetheart, he's hardly worth a broken heart.
The less you have to say about me and Stephen, the better I like it.
Well, I'm only trying to cheer you up. That's more than you do for me.
I'm doing enough just being pleasant to you.
Ah, you have got the gist, Stephen.
Now, you let Mary alone. We're all in the same fix.
Oh, I'm just trying to make her see that life isn't over just because Stephen let her down.
I'm glad you've adjusted to the inevitable, Sylvia.
What do you mean by that crack, darling?
She means what we read in the New York papers this morning. Your husband is marrying Miriam Ahrens of the Vanities.
Why, you little bitch.
No, Sylvia.
Did you know this?
Oh, Sylvia, why do you care? You don't love Howard.
Oh, Mary, how could you do this to me?
I'm terribly sorry, Sylvia.
This humiliation, this carefully timed insult. And after all I've done for you.
And what have you done for me?
I warned you.
I'm not exactly grateful for that.
No, aren't you? Listen to me, you ball of conceit. You're not the object of pity, you suppose. Plenty of the girls are tickled to death you got those coming to you. You deserve to lose Stephen, you stupid way you acted. But I always stood up to you like a loyal friend. What thanks do I get? You knew about this woman you stood by gloating. Why
get out of here. Get out.
I hate you, I hate you. I hate everybody. I hate everybody. You wait. Someday you'll need a woman friend. Then you'll think of me.
Well, that is that. Oh, Mary, what are we doing here? What is happening to us? We're being written off the books, Peggy. But you haven't given up, Mary, not really. You still think in your heart that Stephen will call. Don't you, Mary? Don't you? No. No, Peggy, it's too late. If he were going to call, he wouldn't have waited until now, the very last minute. We need someone to protect us from all this. A woman's best protection is the right man. And obviously, your John isn't the right man, Peggy, and you'll forget all about him in another month. Another month? Oh, no. No, I can't stand it here another moment. Oh, I can't, Mary. I can't.
But Peggy,
what's the matter with you? I'm going to have a baby. Oh, Mary, what shall I do?
Do? Well, there's only one thing to do. New York, operator. Peggy, what's the number?
Eldorado 52075.
Eldorado 52075.
Oh, I can't tell him now. Oh, Mary, I know I was wrong, but it's no use. You just don't know the things he said to me, and I have my pride.
Reno's full of women who all have their pride. Hello? Mr. Day, please. Reno calling. Just hold on a moment.
Hello, John? Oh, no, I'm not sick. Oh, John, I'm going to have a baby. Oh, my dear, are you? Oh, dearest, do you? Oh, dearest, so am I. Of course I forgive you. Oh, yes, precious. Yes, lamb, on the very next train. Oh, Johnny, when I get back, things are going to be so different. And, dear, do you mind if I reverse the charges? Oh, Mary, I've got to pack. Oh, Mary, I can't bear to leave you here alone. Why don't you do something about Stephen?
It's different with me, Peggy. Stephen is marrying another woman, but she doesn't love him. I do. That's the way it is.
But, Mary, why don't you fight for him? Your marriage isn't really ended until you end it.
Fight? Yes. Why not, Peggy? Why not? Fight the way other women fight. You're right, Peggy. It isn't ended, is it? If your heart doesn't say so, it's not ended.
This powder room looks like ladies' night at Madison Square Garden. Here, Peggy, try my lipstick. I can't bear that shade you're using.
Thanks, Sylvia. What do you think of the party?
Gruesome. I hate this club.
You know, Mary is here tonight.
Yes, I saw her. First time she's been out in a year. Why, do you suppose?
She's here because Stephen is here and his new wife.
Well, why should Mary be here? Because Stephen's here. Don't tell me she's still in that punching.
Well, why not? Now, look here, Sylvia. You knew that crystal creature, didn't you?
I met her. What makes you think Mary thinks she has a chance?
I've got a hunch you could tell her that.
Maybe I could.
Oh, what do you mean?
That Stephen of hers is a Puritan. Bless his little Plymouth Rock soul. My psychoanalyst tells me that men of his generation were brought up to believe that wives who carry keys to other apartments are strictly for burning.
What are you talking about?
Well, I shouldn't be talking about it at all. But I will tell you this. I visited this crystal a month ago, and while she was bathing, I rummaged around and came across a key. A little gold key.
A key to what?
To an apartment where the new Mrs. Stephen Haynes' girl, Stephen's old boyfriend, Jim Winston.
Sylvia, you've got to tell Mary.
Tell Mary what, girls?
Oh, Mary, you're looking ravishing. Is this your first night out since Reno?
Yes, darling. I'm a recluse. Stay home and brood.
Mary, you've been sitting out there in that club all night with Jim Winston. I've seen how he is.
Intoxicated as usual, I'll bet.
Yes, Sylvia.
Find out anything, darling?
Plenty. I think he's the secret in Crystal's life.
Aha, so you have been digging. Well, I hope you know what you're talking about, dearie.
Yes, I know what I'm talking about, Sylvia. I know all about Crystal and Jim Winston. And Jim Winston is just waiting for me to cue him so that he can tell Stephen everything about his precious new wife.
Good girl.
Yes, Jim Winston thinks I'm a very much abused gal. His Western chivalry is about to light up like a crepe Suzette.
Well, this couldn't be the little Mary who put herself high on the pedestal above all us poor, downtrodden, unfostered females a year ago.
Now, Sylvia, you have the proof Mary needs. Give her that key.
What key?
My darling, I never become embroiled in divorce actions, other people's. I photograph terribly.
Come on, Sylvia. For once in your life, play ball. Give Mary that key.
Mary, do you mean you'll take that flute's leftovers?
I'll take him, thank you. I love him.
Why, Mary, haven't you any pride?
Pride? That's a luxury a woman in love can't afford.
Well, what do you do if I give you the key?
If it's what I think it is, I'm going out there right now and let Jim Winston tell Stephen the truth, the whole truth about Mrs. Crystal Haynes. Then I'll move in and get him back.
Why, Mary, I believe you will. Well, here, darling, take the key. Incidentally, pet, it's for 807 Gothic Arms, a real flea bag. But the elevator boys make excellent witnesses.
Make way for a lady who is about to fight for her man and no holds barred.
Why, Mary, what a dirty female trick.
I had a year to sharpen my claws, darling. How do you like my nails, Sylvia? Jungle red, pet. Good night, ladies.
Oh, Deborah, Deborah, Darcy. Don't go away, darling. I want to have some girl talk with you in just a moment. Right now, a man named Bing Crosby wants to say something.
By the way, Bing, do you happen to catch Bob Hope's program?
Oh, Ken. The Bob Hope show is an absolute must in the Crosby household.
Good.
Every Tuesday night, we all gulp our dinner down and we dash madly for the radio. We all sit in a semicircle and we pay strict attention.
Oh.
The first one to laugh has to wash the dishes.
Get a game out of it.
Yeah.
Oh, then you heard Bob mention the new Chesterfield poster, the one that shows him holding up the new Chesterfield Christmas carton.
Oh, indeed I did. I heard him plug my Santa Claus likeness on the carton, too.
You know, Bing, you make a very convincing proper Santa Claus.
Well, I've had a modicum of practice, shall we say. Anyway, it's a wonderful gift for just about everyone you want to get a gift for.
Chesterfield, Chesterfield, always winks or flakes. That's milder, mild tobacco, never leaves an aftertaste.
So open a pack, give them a smell.
Then you smoke them.
This Christmas, give Chesterfield Christmas cartons with Bing as Papa Santa Claus.
Hey, Tulu.
What about?
Well, Dean Martin, Jerry Lewis, and I would like to do our version of the women. We call it the fellers.
Let's hear it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Actors' Company. Sydney. What is it, Marvin? I love your drapes. Thank goodness someone noticed them. I've been wearing them for 3 weeks, and my wife never said a word. Before we were married, she noticed everything I wore. You know how we met. I was a car hop at a drive-in.
Oh, I remember when you worked there. You sure could fill a pair of tight slacks.
And then some. Thank you, Marvin. I remember when you were thin, too. Say, speaking of blubber, have you seen Piggy lately?
Not so loud. He's in the next room fixing his face.
Fixing his face? How did he manage to do that? It's so hard to get parts these days.
Gee, here he comes now. Get a load of that hair, will you?
Hair? I thought it was a helmet. Oh, hello!
Peggy. Say, I like your hair.
You mean it? You like this color, jungle red?
Oh, yes, it goes so well with your eyes.
Oh, that's because he cries so much. No woman is worth it, Piggy. There are other fish in the sea.
I don't like fish. I like women.
Look, what are you worried about, Pig? After your wife gets a divorce, you'll find somebody else. There are 2 million women in New York.
Yeah, but they don't want to get married.
How do you know?
I asked them.
Don't cry, Piggy.
I want my wife. I miss my poopsie.
So go out home to your poopsie. Go ahead.
I can't.
Why not?
She hits me.
Besides, I overheard my caddy telling the masseur that Poopsie is going out with Fred.
That's a lot. Fred is going out with Muriel.
But what about Velma?
Velma broke off with Fred when she saw him with Isabel.
What? Isabel? Why, Isabel told Martha that Selma isn't speaking to Miriam since Dolores found that gold key to Maxine's medicine cabinet in Tallulah's slack.
Would you mind repeating the question?
I don't carry tails. And I don't know about you guys, but I'm going out and paint the town red. Jungle red, of course. How about it, Marvin? Want to come along with me?
Yeah, I'd love to, Sidney, but my little six-year-old niece has come to visit me.
Piggy, will you look after Marvin's niece?
Me? But your niece is a stranger to me. Marvin, what is your niece? A boy or a girl?
Well, a girl.
Does she hit? I don't like to be hit by a stranger.
Oh, you'll get along fine with her. Come on, Sidney, let's go.
Okay, see you later, Piggy.
Now I got to take care of a stranger. Oh, me. Oh, my. Golly gee. Here I sit, all alone. Gee, I said I sit all alone and the telephone rang. Oh, it iced me. Hello? Oh, Poopsie, am I glad you called. I'm in terrible trouble. You gotta take me back. I didn't want to tell you this before, but now you gotta take me back. You gotta. I'm expecting a little stranger.
And that was real fun. Well, boys will be boys. And now to the girls. Come on over, Deborah Carr and Dorothy McGuire. Aren't they lovely? Two famous, famous movie actresses. We've all seen and admired many, many times. My very dear friends. Darlings, I keep forgetting which one of you is Deborah Carr.
I am. And which one of you is Tallulah Bankhead?
Darling, there is only one Tallulah Bankhead.
Yes. And isn't her name Betty Davis?
Isn't he sweet? Dorothy McGuire, Dorothy, how are you, dear? I never think of you without remembering the brilliant Claudia that you were. Aren't you ever coming back to Broadway?
Well, I think about it now and then, Tallulah, but my picture work takes all my time. It's not so easy as a theater.
Oh, darling, the theater is quite exhausting.
Exhausting? 2.5 hours a night from 8:30 to 11? What do you do from 11 till 8:30 the next night?
I shake hands with my admirers. Of course, motion picture work is all right, I suppose. I made one here a few years ago. Lifeboat, dear. Doubt if you see it. Oh. Well, anyway, when I finish it, I dash right back to my dear old Broadway.
Didn't they ever call you back to make a sequel? Son of Lifeboat.
Isn't he sweet?
Oh, I've had offers, of course. But you were busy shaking hands.
Yes, Deborah, darling. Well, it's all right to make a picture now and then, but I can't understand how you can stay away from New York so long. The home of the living theater. You especially, Dorothy. Bonds of the theater, you might say.
Oh, I love California. We all do. The palm trees, the coconut trees, the banana trees.
Well, of course, Bongo, if you don't want to leave the Congo. But I prefer Broadway anytime.
I don't know why. We have radio here, too, you know.
Oh, Deborah, I'm not on radio alone. Besides radio, I take an active interest in the theater. I lecture, make records. I'm spread out all over the place.
Yes, dear, but in that dress, it doesn't show at all.
What?
And besides, Tallulah, we don't only make pictures. We have a theater here, which is very much alive, the Actors' Company.
Oh, of course you have, and it's cute to dabble in the arts, I suppose. I'd be glad to join your little group if it will help you out.
Oh, I'm sorry, Tallulah. It's the Actors' Company.
That was the unkindest cut of all. Deborah, you know my work in the theater. You remember me on the stage in England.
Well, I was a small child at the time.
Isn't he sweet? I see, the two of you against me.
You began it.
The two of you picking on me.
You started picking on me.
So I'm not a good actress. Huh?
Now, who was it said which one of you is Deborah Carr?
Nathan Hale. What difference does it make?
Was it a joke, or are your eyes bad?
Oh, I spent a lifetime in the theater.
If you'll admit your eyes are bad, I'll apologize.
You stand there and tell me I can't join your actor's company.
Was it a joke, or was it your eyes?
How the mighty have fallen.
Was it your eyes? Look, how many fingers am I holding up?
12, for what? To think that the name of Zula Bankhead, a symbol of the living theater, should be destroyed and ground to ashes. This is the unkindest cut of all.
Oh, Tallulah, I'm sorry.
Oh, dear, please don't take it this way.
Of course, you're a great actress. We were only joking.
Oh, we apologize, Tallulah. It would break my heart to see you crying.
Act of company, indeed. Well, darling, that's our show for this week. We're now for New York again, where we'll bring you next week, Sunday, Christmas Eve, and what a load of presents we'll distribute. Jimmy Durante, Bert Law, Robert Merrill, Margaret O'Brien, Edith Piaf, Fran Warren, Ed Wynn, and Meredith Wilson of the Big Show Oxford Chorus, and we are dedicating our Christmas Eve show to all our men in uniform all over the world. Until then, darlings, may the good Lord bless you.
The Big Show, the Sunday night feature of NBC's All-Star Festival, has been brought to you by your local Ford dealer, who is now displaying the new 1951 Ford, the car that's built for the years ahead. By RCA Victor, world leader in radio, first in recorded music, first in television. By Chesterfield, the only cigarette that combines mildness with no unpleasant aftertaste. And by the makers of Anacin, for fast relief from pain of headache, neuritis, and neuralgia. Martin and Lewis appeared through the courtesy of Hal Wallace, producer of Dark City.